गुड मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रेन, वेलकम टू क्लास 6 आईआईटी केमिस्ट्री। चिल्ड्रेन, इन प्रीवियस क्लासेस वी हैव स्टडीड अबाउट द वाटर, इट्स प्रॉपर्टीज एंड वाटर पोल्यूशन, रेन वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग। ओके चिल्ड्रेन, इन दिस क्लास वी विल डील सम हायर ऑर्डर थिंकिंग क्वेश्चंस। हायर ऑर्डर मीन्स दीज क्वेश्चंस वी हैव टू आंसर देम विथ some logics. So first question is, water is said to be a transparent, colorless, tasteless liquid. How drinking water has some taste? Explain. So in previous classes we have studied about the water is said to be transparent, colorless, tasteless liquid. But see, if we are drinking the water, so we will have the taste. So why this drinking water has taste and the remaining water has not taste? See, drinking water contains some dissolved gases and salts. That's why the drinking water has taste. Otherwise, if dissolved gases and salts are not present, then the water will be colorless and also the tasteless. So this is the reason why the drinking water is taste. In drinking water, dissolved gases such as carbon dioxide gas and oxygen is present, and one more is dissolved salts, mineral salts are present, sodium chloride and mineral salts are present. Hence the drinking water has taste. Then the next question is, in cold countries, hot water pipes are arranged inside the concrete floors and walls. Why? See, if I am taking the cold countries such as America or Canada, while constructing the houses, they will place the water pipes inside the concrete floors or inside the walls. Why? What is the reason why they are going to place, or why they are going to put these water pipes in floors or walls? Concrete means what? The mixture of sand, stones and the cement, that is called concrete. So this concrete is going to be used to construct the houses. So children, here this, in this way, while constructing in cold countries, they will place the pipes. Okay, and again on this the concrete is going to be poured. Why these pipes are placed? Because see, water has high specific heat capacity. You already know what is specific heat capacity. Okay, so here see, when the water is circulated, that means we are connecting these pipes to a bore or a motor, then automatically the water will be coming to these pipes, and these are going to be circulated. When these pipes, if the water is circulated, automatically some heat is evolved or some heat is radiated. So due to that heat, so these walls and the concrete floor will become hot. So because of this, in cold countries, so they are going to feel somewhat hot. This is the reason why they are going to place the water pipes in the concrete floors or the walls. So once again I'm saying, water has high heat capacity, specific heat capacity. When water is circulated through pipes inside these floors and walls, so these, that means see, when the water is flowing, automatically it will, some heat energy is evolved. That heat, evolution of heat energy is called radiates. That means this water radiates heat slowly to the building, therefore keeping the inside the building warm. That means due to this heat energy, the building becomes little bit warm. So that means inside the, it will, we are going to feel somewhat hot. For that is the reason why in cold countries, hot water pipes are arranged inside the concrete floors and walls. The main reason is due to the movement of water in the pipes, this water radiates heat. So this heat keeps inside the building warm. This is the main reason why the pipes are placed. That means why the water pipes are placed inside the floors and the walls of the building in cold countries. Okay, children. So the next question is, water in swimming pools remains cool even during hot summer. Why? Or explain. See, in summer season, children, you will go for swimming. Where you will go? To the swimming pools. Even if you are going at mid time, also the water is cool only. What is the reason? Even in the summer season, that means in the hot season or a hot summer also, the swimming pools remain cool. What is the reason why the water is cool in hot summer in the swimming pools? Okay, children, the main reason is water has high specific heat capacity and requires large amount of heat for raising the temperature. That means to change 1 gram of water to water vapor, so some high amount of heat capacity is required. So due to that reason, the water in the swimming pools remains cool even during the hot summer also. Okay, to change the water to the vapors, high amount of heat is required. So that's why in swimming pools we won't have high amount of heat. That's why the water will be cool. This is the reason why the swimming pools remains cool even during the hot summer. So the next question is, some ice cubes are kept in a beaker and a thermometer is placed in it. Okay, children, some ice cubes are kept in a beaker or in a glass, and in that glass with the ice cubes you are placing on thermometer. What could be the change in the temperature observed in the thermometer? See, if you are placing the thermometer in that, are you going to observe any change in the thermometer? Justify, that means explain. See here, when I am placing the ice cubes in a beaker and I am placing the same thermometer, then here I am seeing the reading. That means we are going to see the reading here. Okay, so here it is showing 0 degrees Celsius. Now the temperature in the thermometer remains same until the ice melts. That means the total amount of ice that is present in the beaker melts. Till that time, the temperature shown by the thermometer will be 0 degrees Celsius, because see, ice melts at 0 degrees Celsius to water. Okay, when total ice is melt, automatically slowly the temperature increases due to the heat that is present outside the beaker. Then slowly the temperature rises. After the total ice is melt, then it starts raising the temperature. This is the reason why. So if you are placing the ice cubes in a beaker and you are placing a thermometer in it, there will be no change in the temperature until the total ice is melt or changes to water. The heat observed from the surroundings is utilized for the conversion of solid state to liquid state by overcoming intermolecular force of attraction. So children, why the ice is melting? Because see, in surroundings, some heat is present. That heat is observed by these ice pieces. Okay, that heat is called as latent heat of fusion. Already we studied in previous classes what is latent heat of fusion. 1 gram of ice melts to the amount, the temperature required for to melt 1 gram of ice to water. That heat is called latent heat. Okay, but the temperature won't changes. So here the intermolecular force of attraction between the two molecules, some force of attraction is present. In solids, the force of attraction will be very close. Okay, when some external heat is, that means when these ice cubes are taking the heat from the surroundings, automatically the force will be reduced and slowly this ice will changes to water. Okay, so this is the reason. This is also one more reason, because the heat observed by the ice and the intermolecular forces of attraction will become less and it changes to water. Okay, so the next question is, some amount of salt is added to a beaker of water and stirred. See, I'm taking one beaker, and in that beaker I'm adding some salt and water, and I'm stirring with a spoon. Then how can you separate the component from the above mixture? Explain. That means automatically the salt will dissolve in it. Okay. Then how will you separate the salt and the mixture? Children, how we are getting the salt from the seawater? Any idea? So here the seawater is taken in a field, and slowly due to the evaporation, all the water will be evaporated. Only impurity solid substance is present. That solid substance is called salt. Then after purification process is gone, that means all the impurities that are present in the salt will be removed slowly. Then we are get the purified and iodized salt. So here the salt dissolves in water, forming a salt solution. That means I'm taking a salt in a beaker and I'm adding water to it and I'm stirring it. Then when the salt is dissolves in the water, it forms a salt solution. It is called a mixture. Mixture of salt and water is called salt solution, and it is called as salt water mixture or solution, salt solution. So on evaporation, that means you take that mixture and heat it, automatically the total water will be evaporated and a solid part is present at the down of the beaker. Then that part is called salt. On evaporation of this solution, water vaporizes, leaving behind the salt crystals. Okay. Again, by the distillation, it is possible to recover the salt and water, mainly by the evaporation or even by the distillation also. We'll see. See, live example I'm saying. Okay, children, your mothers are going to cook the food. Okay? Or you take one pan, heat it. You pour the salt water on the hot pan. You are going to see on the hot pan a white patch is present. Okay, then total water will be evaporated and only the white patch is present. That white patch is the salt. In this way we can separate the salt and the water. Okay, children, mainly by the evaporation. So the next one more question, why distilled water is unfit for consumption? That means for drinking. Distilled water, I already said about the distillation process and where this distilled water is used. In last class we have discussed. Okay, why distilled water is not fit for drinking or consumption? Why? What is the reason? Distilled water doesn't contain the minerals, salts required for the body, and it does not possess adequate amount of dissolved gases. In distilled water, no more impurities are present. Even the dissolved salts are not present and the gases are not present. It is totally free from germs, and also it is tasteless and a pure transparent liquid. Hence, even we know drinking water, in first question we already discussed, in drinking water some dissolved gases are present and salts are present that are required by the body, by our human body. Otherwise, if the water doesn't contain these mineral salts and dissolved gases, so if you are drinking that water also, it is no use. So that is the reason. So hence, distilled water has blend taste. Blended is flavorless, no taste. Okay, see, this distilled water mainly used for the automobile industry and medicine. See, in automobile industry, where you are going to use this? In last class, I already said about the automobile. This, the main reason is about the, we are going to use them in car batteries, and also in medicine means for the injection sake or for the saline bottles, we will use them. So the next question is, explain how the exposure of water to air and sunlight purify the water. To what extent this method is effective? So your exposure of water to air and sunlight means that is evaporation. But for how much time? this method is effective. So here air contains oxygen. As oxygen helps in burning, when water is exposed to air and sunlight, the germs are burned to death. So that's okay. So here oxygen contains, mainly we already know oxygen is used for burning. Okay, due to sunlight, some heat is evolved. Due to that heat helps. Okay, this oxygen helps the heat to burn the substance, burn the germs that are present in water, and they will die. So that is why in towns, reservoirs is exposed to air and sunlight over the large surface area. See, we are having the Manay Dam. So the total water is exposed to air and sunlight. So due to the sun's rays, the top layer of the water will be evaporated and the water will become hot. At that time, whatever the impurities that are present in that water, slowly they will die. Okay. Okay, children. The next, and dude, so that water slowly, the next, the water will be circulated, and slowly the one more layer will come, and the same process will be continuing. And one more question is, how do fertilizers cause water pollution? How these fertilizers, that means inorganic fertilizers or artificial fertilizers, causes water pollution? See children, yeah, we are adding some chemicals and pesticides to these plants. Okay, these, when we are watering to these automatically, so that these fertilizers will dissolve in water and slowly seeps into the soil. Okay, then when the rain falls on this soil, again this water or these automatically seeping, and it is mixing with the soil. Then it is mixing with the soil, again the rain water is seeping into this. Slowly these chemicals will mix with the water table. In this way the water is polluted. See up, if excess amount of chemicals we are using, and due to the rain, automatically they are going to mix with the water bodies and causes water pollution. See, fertilizers contains nitrogen salts, which are highly soluble in water. These salts are leached, means drain or seep away by the rainwater, and reach the water bodies and makes the water acidic. Okay, see, we already know the main inorganic fertilizers contains potassium, nitrogen, and sulfur. These salts are highly soluble. See, if I are adding little amount of water, automatically they will dissolve. Okay, these salts, when we are adding the pesticides and watering the plants, so these pesticides water will seep or drain into the soil. When the rain falls on that, slowly the same water will be reaching to the water table and causes the pollution of the water. So this is the reason why in this way the fertilizers are also causes water pollution. So in this way fertilizers cause water pollution. So children, here I'm taking 100 grams of water and 100 grams of steam. So I'm collecting 100 grams of water and 100 grams of steam at 100 degrees Celsius. Both are at 100 degrees Celsius. Then what is the extra amount of heat energy possessed by steam than water? So here, how much extra amount of heat energy is having the steam than the water? Okay. So here I'm taking 100 grams of water and 100 grams of steam at 100 degrees Celsius. Now see, 1 gram of water requires 540 calories of heat for getting converted into steam. So already we discussed about this. So here 1 gram contains, that means to convert 1 gram of water to steam, we require 540 calories of heat energy. So in the same way, for 100 grams, how much I need? Okay, in the same way, for how much I have to need, that is 100 into 540. 1 gram of water, 540 calories. Then 100 grams of water, 540 into 100. Then after simplification, I'll get 54,000 calories or 54 kilo calories. That means these 1,000 I'm going to saying as kilo. 1,000 is equal to kilo or not? So that's why 54 kilo calories of heat is extra required. Okay, more than one, that is 100 grams of water. That means 54 kilocalories of extra amount of heat energy is possessed by steam water than normal water at 100 degrees Celsius. So in the same way, children, calculate the heat required to convert 250 grams of ice into water at 0 degrees Celsius. That means I have to convert 250 grams of ice to water at 0 degrees Celsius. That means the temperature should not be changing, but only the heat. How much heat is required to convert this? That is latent heat of fusion. Okay, so 1 gram required, that means 1 gram of ice requires 80 calories of heat. Okay, that is at 0 degrees Celsius. If the temperature is increasing, automatically the calories, that means the latent heat of fusion is also increases. So for 1 gram of ice, 80 calories required. Then what about 250 grams? That 250 grams means 250 into 80 calories. So total we are going to get 20,000 calories or 20,000 kilocalories of heat is required to convert 250 grams of ice to water. Okay. The next one more question. Calculate the heat required to convert 10 grams of ice at 0 degrees Celsius to 10 grams of water at 100 degrees Celsius. So here I need to calculate the heat required to convert 10 grams of ice at 0 degrees Celsius to 10 grams of water at 100 degrees Celsius. So here specific heat is given, that is 1 calorie per 1 gram per degree Celsius. The amount of heat energy required to 10 grams of ice at 0 degrees Celsius to 10 grams of water at 100 degrees Celsius is equal to, that is for 1 gram we already know 80 calories ice to water at 0 degrees, that is 10 grams, 10 into 80 calories, that is 800 calories of heat is required. The heat required to convert 10 grams of water at 0 degrees to 100 degrees Celsius is 10 into 100 into 1. That means 10 grams of water, so I am converting it into at 100 degrees Celsius, that's equal to 1000 calories. Then total energy will be 1000 plus 800 is equal to 1800 calories of heat is required to convert 10 grams of ice at 0 degrees Celsius to 10 grams of water at 100 degrees Celsius. Okay. So children, by this, we will conclude the chapter number, this chapter number 11, that is water, a precious resource. And in next class, we'll continue about the amazing air. What is air? What are the properties of air and everything? Children, the worksheet will be given and you have to complete the worksheet. Thank you. Have a good day.